Good afternoon, and thanks for coming out to the lecture today. We're really blessed to have Carl Elefante here from Washington, D.C. For the college lecture. I was been asked to give an introduction, and while I have his bio, I'm just going to say a few things that I know about Carl and some of the work he's done. Carl's the principal and the director of sustainability for Quinn Evans Architects. They're based out of Ann Arbor, Michigan, and Washington, D.C., but also have offices in Detroit, Baltimore, and Madison, Wisconsin. And this afternoon, Carl said that they are an architecture firm with a big A, but then he described the work they do and the people that they work with. And you start to realize that even though they're an architecture firm, it really comes from a diverse practice of working with cultural landscapes. Working with cultural landscapes, working with blighted neighborhoods in Detroit, working in the preservation of heritage resources across the country, working with campuses and universities, and a wide range of other project types. So the idea of bringing in the diversity of our college and looking at the work that Quinn Evans does, I think it's a nice match. Because it brings in efforts of planning, of landscape, and architecture. So Carl was educated at Pratt University and the University of Maryland, and as I've come to find out, sort of bleeds, I don't even know the color of that. He bleeds like a Terrapin. I'm very proud of that. Just like I hope all you guys sort of bleed cardinal and white. Most recently, his efforts have been aimed at leadership in the American Institute of Architects. Carl is currently the first vice president, and he'll be the national president starting the first of the year for 2018. So, we're really blessed to have Carl here today, and please join me in welcoming Carl Elefante.
So hopefully I even figured out how to turn on the mic. It seems like I have. Thanks, Jonathan. Seems a little boomy here. Sounds a little boomy to you? Sound okay to you out there? Okay. So kind of back at you for Jonathan Spodak. Jonathan calls and asks me to do something, the answer is yes. Jonathan, in the preservation field, is one of those people that really understands both the academic side and the practice side. And so it's a real pleasure to be here at his invitation. I am an architect. I do practice in an office that does mostly historic preservation and existing building work. But I have to confess that my head is completely into being a president in 2018. When I write a date down, I have to cross out the 8 and write in a 7 because it's still 2017. My head is there. I'm in 2018. So essentially, everything I say to you today will be colored by the time and attention that I'm putting into to try to lead the American Institute of Architects the best way I can for a year. And a year is not a very long time. And there's not that much that as a person, as a president of the American Institute of Architects can really affect. But I feel the challenge for me is to understand what's happening in our profession, what we can actually address in our profession in 1 year, and by the way, that year is 2018, to have the best possible outcome that it can have and to do the most for our profession that it can do. So I've been thinking about that for about a year and a half. It colors everything I'm gonna talk about today. With that preliminary, I really wanna start by just giving you a couple of perspectives that do come from being an architect in the world that I face 5 or 6 or 7 days a week. And it's two parts of it, two very different parts of it. In a way, I'll call it almost like the carrot and the stick. The fears, you know, this is like the SWOT analysis. These are the threats and the opportunities of the architectural profession. And literally, these things are experiences that have grown out of my practice. The first relates to this person, Josh Linkner, who is a high-tech entrepreneur who literally moved back to Detroit because he thought that what he needed to do for the world, he could do better in Detroit. His hometown needed him back, bringing his billions, by the way. It's always a good thing to have his quality to bring back to your hometown. But he came to us 2 years ago at an AIA grassroots conference and told us about his world of innovative disruption. And he left us with a challenge, which was find your disruption. If you don't find it, someone else will. And as a person that was considering being president of the American Institute of Architects, I thought that that might be something that was actually worth my attention. I started to think about it, and I realized, wait a minute, I'm living this. And the project that you see here, which is a dormitory at Gallaudet University in Washington, D.C., was a project that we did using our Revit models. And at a point when we were into design development, we literally gave that Revit model in a design build framework, which is how the project was being done, to the mechanical, electrical, plumbing, fire protection, fire alarm, IT contractors, and even also a proprietary structural contractor that literally designed a structural system that was a pre-engineered structural system. So about 50% of the engineering for this project was done by licensed engineers working for general contractors and subcontractors, not working for us as a design architect. So literally, the fees to our engineers were about half of what they normally were. This is coming to our profession, that we today develop these incredibly sophisticated, smart, intelligent tools with the BIM models and things like that that we create. But then what do we do to communicate with them? We derive from them stupid drawings and give those to people to communicate. So we take a smart product and we develop a stupid product from it. How long do you think that's going to last? It's not going to last much longer. The intelligence is where our future lies. So that's the disruptive side. And frankly, it's pretty frightening. Profound. I'll say one more thing about it from my own life. When I was in high school, I got a job as an office boy. That was my title, office boy, for an architectural firm in Summit, New Jersey, where I grew up. And it was about 30 people, 10 registered architects, 20 career draftsmen. All of those career draftsman jobs are all gone. So I've seen in my lifetime 30 jobs turn into 10 jobs. So again, this is one of the disruption is coming. Are you going to let them figure it out, or should we figure it out? The second is another story from my real world practice, which was interviewing for this school design. By the way, we got the job, so it's not a, there's a silver lining to this story. And we, of course, went to this interview, showed them all our great work that we'd done, talked about what an important project it was and what a terrific job we were going to do. And when we were done with our awesome Dog and Pony show, the first question out of the mouth of the selection committee was, okay, smart architect, how will your design affect the educational outcome of our students? And the five of us who had interviewed, we all like looked at each other like, okay, who's got that question? And we realized that none of us had that question. And that none of us had really started at square one, which was not that we were satisfying the program according to the Virginia educational standards. You know, not that we were meeting the budget, not that we were meeting the schedule, but that the work that we were going to do would impact the lives of generations of students that would come to our facility, and that environment would help shape the educational experience that they would have. And I want to tell you that it has changed our practice, that our, what was K through 12 studio and higher education studio, it's now our lifelong learning studio. And it's very closely married to our museum and cultural studio and so on. And it's like, oh my gosh, that's right. The impacts that our work has on literally developing the cognitive abilities and the sense of self and so on of the people that are occupying our spaces, that's what really matters. That's what matters to the clients that are hiring us to do our work. So it led me to the title of this talk. And I think something that is about trying to recognize what we can do in a year to change our own mindset about the work that we do. And that is, we like to talk about design mattering, but really it's design impact that matters. The impact of our design on the people whose lives we shape. We shape buildings, we shape places, but in doing so we shape lives. So that's my thesis that I will pursue. As I began to look into this, I realized that actually I hadn't invented this thought, and that actually this well-known architect has probably made the best statement on this that I've ever seen. As Churchill was debating rebuilding Parliament after the Second World War, there was a lot of talk about what a crummy room it was, and he basically made the point, no, the culture that is created in the House of Parliament, the House of Commons, to have people on this side and people on that side yelling at each other until they got to an agreement, that was a culture that they did not want to disrupt. It had been working for 500 years. They didn't want to change that culture. So he made this statement. And I think that if there's anything that, you know, each of us should come out of architecture school understanding, is this statement. Now, I want to stress that when I talk about us shaping lives, this is not some nice theory, abstract concept. It can mean life and death issues, literally life and death issues. And I'll give you the example of New York City, 19th century example of this. So in New York City, after the end of the Civil War, when killing each other with guns was no longer the factor in statistics, in New York City, roughly two-thirds of the deaths in New York City were the result of infectious disease. So cholera, dysentery, tuberculosis were the major killers in New York City. In 1940, when penicillin becomes readily available and is the medical treatment for infectious disease, is now available widely, that number has already dropped to 11%. Well, how did it go from 64 to 11%? It happened with changes in the built environment. So many of these things are things that we would call infrastructure, you know, water systems, sewer systems, stormwater systems, things like that. There were also changes in buildings, having building codes that required light and air into habitable spaces, so you would have more get respiratory diseases just by inhabiting buildings. So the built environment solved the public health issues of the day by changing the built environment. Architects were part of this, and I'm going to come back and really talk about the specific contribution that architects made to this. But this is not an abstract concept that somehow or another we shape the lives of people. This is life and death. This is real, that we shape people's lives by shaping the environment that they live in. Another sort of preliminary is to try to understand sort of where we are at a point in time. And this Arnold J. Toynbee quote, I think, is the one that, again, says this as profoundly as Churchill's did. And that is, he looked back at the 20th century as a historian, and look at this statement. It's not the wars that mattered. And the 20th century had some pretty darn good wars, okay? It's not the technical development that matters. And look, the 20th century went from horse and buggy to landing on the moon. That's pretty amazing technological development. And he's saying, no, that's not what matters. What matters is that for the first time, humankind can think about the well-being of everyone as a practically achievable goal. And that's what the 20th century really is most important for. Pretty amazing statement. Can we do that? Can we think about the well-being of humankind? And think of the level of cooperation that it takes to achieve that. And I would just make the point that actually we exist in a world that has that level of cooperation in every day. That since 1945, we've had mutually assured destruction that has been available to us at the pump, you know, just the pressing of a button. And we have agreed as a species to not do that to each other. So, can we do that with climate change? Can we still find ways to agree with each other universally to achieve universal goals for the well-being of all people? I think it's practically achievable. If the 20th century is when we conceived that this was possible, the 21st century is when we're being asked to actually do it. If we don't do it with climate change like we did it with mutually assured destruction, we are mutually assuring our destruction. So now let's get into the kind of what does this mean for us as architects, and how does this affect our practice as architects? There are two international agreements that I want to reference here, because I think that it changes the notion of thinking globally and acting globally. That the thinking globally part has sort of reached a new place. So the first is Habitat 3 and Quito Summit, what derived from that the New Urban Agenda. And for us in the architectural professions and the other professions that contribute to the built environment, what this really means is that the world as the world community, literally 200 nations, got together and said, our future is the cities. That number one, population is going to continue to grow astronomically, even at somewhat higher level than we've seen over the last 70 years. Basically, the next 50 years, we'll see more growth than the last 70 or 80 years has. Just to give you an idea, the world population is going to grow by the population of China by 2030. Okay, so we're just going to have another China's worth of people to feed by 2030. The other thing that the Quito Summit focused on is that essentially everyone is going to live in cities. And a really important threshold that was crossed in the last decade is that more than 50% of the population of the world now lives in urbanized settings. So more people wake up, look out the window, and see a building in the morning than see a tree. That trend is going to accelerate, and certainly by the end of the century, it depends on which study you look at, it might even be by 2050, something like 80% of the world population will be in urbanized areas. So anybody in this room know about the built environment, know about urbanized areas, kind of professionally involved in it? We all are. This summit is saying architects, engineers, landscape architects, planners, you are at the nexus of what will happen over the next generation of humankind. The second international agreement is the Paris Agreement on climate change. And I'll tell you a couple of stories about this, but I think the bottom line is something that is pretty easy to get to. The bottom line is that we're being asked to design to a new building code. And the new building code requires us to design to net zero carbon. So zero. Zero is a scary number, very low number, right? But we actually know how to design to zero. We do it all the time. How many people is it okay to have die in your building because of a fire? I think the number is zero. Been a long time that it's been accepted. For 100 years, building codes have accepted that the right number is zero. How many people is it okay to get killed in your building from an earthquake? The number is zero. And for about the last 30 or 40 years, there have been codes around the world about zero is how many people it's okay to die in your building from an earthquake. We can change our practice to figure out how to work with zero being the right number to work with. It's doable. We know how to design to criteria. We have a new criteria, design to zero carbon. These things are becoming codified through the United Nations and other bodies. We are not in a little lifeboat alone out in the middle of the ocean. There's a lot of people for us to reference. There's a lot of work that's been done by other fields for us to be part of. Let's embrace that. It will help us. excuse me. So I want to get into, again, my sort of personal vision of this from my exposure as a practicing architect. And I want to start by saying it's time for us to get over the word city and urban. Cities are not just some of the places we live. Every place we live is a city. The first city in the world is less than 5,000 people. It doesn't take New York City to be a city. All human settlement that is about communities of people coming together and living as a community, they're all cities. They're all urban, even if they're out in the countryside. Okay? So let's not have this urban-rural dilemma, dynamic between us. Because we're all talking about doing the same thing, shaping people's lives, providing the same goods and services, making people's lives better in the same ways. It doesn't matter the size of the place that we're talking about. Ed Glaser kind of says it really well. He really, really drives home the point that whether you're in Houston, Texas, or cornfield in Iowa or in New York City, every one of those places is trying to create the conditions to advance human civilization. So I'm going to give you my Dave Letterman top 10 list. And this is presented for the purpose, one purpose only, and that is, I'll call it relatability. That we don't have to get interested in things that we aren't currently interested in. We can take the topics that we are interested in and understand how they fit into this context and use that as our window into doing these truly global things that we're being asked to address. So this is our own sort of act locally. These are the things that we as architects are embracing in one way or another. So I'm going to go through these pretty quickly. I'll just kind of mention them. So first is this whole notion that we are biological creatures. We live in the biosphere. The built environment is not a separate thing from the natural environment. It's actually part of the natural environment. And either it's being appropriate in being part of the biosphere, or it's interfering with the biosphere. It's up to us to sort of sort through this, and it's one of the big sortings that will take place in the 21st century. The other thing that is a dimension of this is, where do we look for models of what the next generation of design needs to look like? There are a lot of people saying, look to nature, because in the end, those things we build need to be literally part of the biosphere, part of nature. There's a lot of good work being done. Peter Kalbar's work is, I think, really excellent. I recommend you take a look at it. The unfortunate thing is that most of this really good work is not being done in the United States of America, being done in China, being done in places like that. We're taking our good thinking, and other people are benefiting from it. We're not putting nearly enough attention into benefiting from it right here. The second, fitness and health and wellness, a huge topic. Talking about social relevance, what could possibly be more socially relevant than healthcare? You know, I mean, look at all the discussion that is literally in the newspapers today still about how do we deal with human health and well-being. Boris Luzhniak came to the AIA in 2014, and he went around the room and pointed to everybody and said, you are all public health officials. What you do as architects literally shape the health and well-being of the people that occupy your cities and your buildings. And there's a lot of good work that's been done on this, things like Fit City and Fit Nation, and well-building standards and things like that. Again, there's a lot of literature for us to relate to here. I think probably the person who has personified this the best is Dr. Richard Jackson, who literally talks about things that we consider to be health crises, and he looks at them as actually crises in how we build. And really, that person didn't die of a heart attack. That person died of not having an environment that she could walk through and get to a grocery store without being overly exposed to heat and humidity. The third is food. And it's something that, again, in our perspective in this country, this is actually a tough one for us to relate to mostly, because we just have this wealth of food that we literally get from all around the world. Vandana Shiva is probably the most articulate person that I've ever heard talk about climate change. And her message to us about climate change is that the consequences is not sea level rise, it's not worse storms. Is that something's going to happen that's going to disrupt the food supply. And that we're on a hair trigger in terms of having enough food for the world. And when that happens, the consequences will be disastrous. It will literally be mass starvations. I came out of a lecture by her chilled, to say the least. This is a wonderful study, the University of Arkansas, the Fayetteville Food City Study, that looks at the city of 250,000, and it shows a way that that city can become food independent. And I think that there's a food city study you can do for every city in the country. It used to be, by the way, that every city in the country was food independent. You know where New York City got its food? Brooklyn. Literally, Brooklyn was the farm that supplied food in New York City for its first. I want to go back and make another point here about This isn't kind of theory. This is real life. This is my community. And this is, these are maps that show racial distribution in the city, poverty distribution in the city, obesity distribution in the city, and food deserts. All four maps line up. They're all the same map. These are results of patterns of development. They didn't just happen. They were installed. Excuse me, I'm running out of voice here. Number four is material city. And I would just, particularly to the architects in the room, ask you a question. Who owns materials? Architects own materials. Who decides where buildings will be built at? You know, who picks that wood paneling to go in that office? We are the ones that are the designated material choosers of the work we do. How much do we know about the materials that we choose? Do we know about their health consequences? Do we know about their resource consequences? And actually the answer to the health is kind of increasing. You know, people are really beginning to pay attention to toxicity and you know, other aspects of health impacts. On the resource side, we are just scratching the surface. We are just beginning to really understand, as whole system-wise, what happens when we decide to build a building out of concrete, or steel, or wood. And the work of people like Peter Busby, who actually is designing buildings who have net positive climate impact. He's actually building buildings mostly out of wood that sequester carbon instead of release carbon. So again, we can do it. We just have to have it be a factor in our thinking. And for the preservationist in me, just makes me not want to leave this topic alone yet. And I just want to make a point about us understanding building life cycles. That buildings we know are assemblages of very complex systems. Stuart Brand gave us the language in his book about recognizing that some of the aspects of the buildings that we build are by nature extremely durable. And I'll give you the example of, you know, you having to design a building like this, it probably is a 1A building, you know, concrete, got to be a concrete structure that withstands fire, things like that. Well, that requirement says that you must build a really, really, really durable building. Okay. Well, where in the code does it say, since you're going to design a really durable building, these are the design factors that you should have in mind for how that building will remain relevant and remain usable and be a good investment of those resources for 500 or 1,000 years. There's not a single word in the code. Excuse me again. One other reason why I want to continue to dwell on this is its relationship to the climate change agreement and what this means in terms of carbon. Understanding the embodied carbon of the buildings that we design and build is our future. We have to begin to do that, like now. And in order to meet the 2050 goals of getting to zero net carbon by 2050, we have to reduce our current footprint by 50%. So we need to understand what we're building and how we're building, and literally stop making buildings that are more resource intensive and more carbon creating than they need to be. Fortunately, again, there's a lot of literature and there's a lot of tools for us to use. So, you know, these are two diagrams from the European ISO standards that begin to categorize these impacts. So we actually have a language to reference. And then the bottom diagram is from the TALI program, which is developed by Kieran Timberlake, that you can use as a design tool while you're doing your design and compare strategies and find out whether one is more carbon intensive than the other. So you actually have some evidence on which to base your decisions. So we can do this. You know, this is something that you guys as students should be getting intelligence. So zero net city, I already introduced this. Let's not be afraid of the number zero. And so Ed Mazzaria is really the person that changed the climate summit. He went to Paris, he told the story of the American Institute of Architects and the American architectural community and the work that we've done. And this is the story he told, which is that since 2006, when I started tracking energy consumption in buildings, that in the US, we were able to add 20 billion square feet of new building without, as a sector, consuming any more energy. Well, how did we do that? We basically do that with two activities. One is design buildings that actually have energy in mind and are higher performing buildings. And what we're seeing from the AIA 2030 commitment program is that getting to about 40% reduction in energy is something that you should be able to do on every project, really. Getting to 70 or 80%, which is the real goal that we'd like to have essentially every building hit, will take more time and energy to get there. The other thing that we did was we retrofitted buildings to be more energy efficient. We put LED lights in them instead of incandescent lights. We put mechanical systems in them that are energy efficient instead of energy hogs. Pretty simple, straightforward stuff. But we did it widely enough to bring that red line down to the green line. That story in Paris created goodwill and created a sense of confidence that actually we could meet these targets. And it helped the conversation change from 2100 to 2050. And help the conversation change from 2 degrees Celsius to 1.5 degrees Celsius. So who did that? We did that. The American architects had that impact on this world conversation. So with this roadmap, what do we need to do? We need to do four things. We know how to do all of these. One is we need to continue to do high-performance buildings, buildings that achieve 70 or 80% below ASHRAE 2006 numbers. We can do that. The Code Top 10 every year publishes building after building that has achieved those goals, if not more. We can do it. We have to work with our clients. We have to convince ourselves and everybody around us that this is doable. The second thing we need to do is we need to renovate buildings and bring the existing building footprint down 50%. To do that, Architecture 2030 projections are that we need to triple or even quadruple the level of renovation that we're currently doing. I don't know about you, but when I hear quadrupling the amount of renovation that we have to do, I hear jobs program. I hear guaranteed work for architects for a generation. That's what I hear when I hear that. We just have to be willing to work with existing buildings. The third thing that we need to do is the materials aspect that we just talked about. We need to build our buildings out of things that have smaller carbon footprints. We can use wood for making structures, things like that, that simply bring that number down. And again, our goal is to bring it down 50%. And then the fourth thing that we need to do is we need to use more renewable energy. And the number here is we need to double it by 2050. We'll double it in 10 years. No problem getting it in, you know, to hit the renewable energy targets. Number six, there's a lot of discussion about security, of course, today. And more of that discussion goes to factors that are not human factors in our security. You know, if you ever wanted to see a better example of what we're talking about, just look at the newspapers over the last 6 months. You know, Harvey, Maria, my goodness. This isn't about niceties, this is about survival. And to have cities that can survive the environment's changing. And I just want to point to this big project. This came out after Hurricane Sandy. Within a few months after Sandy, they kind of FEMA regulations and so on. They looked at the, you know, what's going on with storm surge and sea rise and so on. And they basically came back to New York City and said, well, if you don't want Sandy to happen again, you need to put a 12-foot wall around Manhattan. So what did the architects do? The architects said, that doesn't sound like a very good solution. I don't even think the engineers thought that was a very good solution. So what did they propose? And this was one proposal to essentially create a high line around Manhattan using berms and other elements to make it so that there was this hiker-biker trail going all the way around Manhattan, this park encircling Manhattan. And oh, by the way, it would take care of a 12-foot storm surge. So that's the kind of value that we bring as design thinking to these types of questions. This is what we need to do to make our contribution to these types of problems. Lance Hosey talks about how deep does this go? What are the types of buildings that we're giving design awards to? Is it buildings that perform well, or buildings that you can take a good photograph of? Can't we do both? Can't we have beautiful buildings that we can take photographs of and that we can actually live in and have them be wonderful, inspiring places to live in, and also have them perform well? I think that's a design challenge that we should be able to meet. Number seven. We all talk about transit-oriented development and things like that, but I actually think that in this world of connectivity, this is the best story that I know. So Janet Sadik Khan was appointed transportation secretary in New York City, a cabinet level, you know, position in New York City, and went to her boss, Michael Bloomberg, mayor of New York City, and said, I have wonderful news for you. We have so much public space in this city, I don't even know what to do with it. And of course, Bloomberg said, okay, you're insane, right? We don't have nearly enough public space. She said, oh no, we have more than we know what to do with. We just call them streets, and we give them to the cars. Well, it's time for us to take them back, because we need more public space for our people, the people that vote. The cars don't vote, the people vote. So she got Bloomberg's attention. Then what was her proposal? Her proposal was to take the busiest street in the city, in the busiest intersection in the city, and close the street. So she took Broadway, going right through Times Square, and she closed it. And what happened? She created the most active pedestrian space in New York City. Times Square is just unbelievable. There was never any room for people there. Now there is. There's a spontaneous event going on there every hour of every day because the opportunity was provided by providing space for that opportunity. And by the way, the traffic before she closed Broadway was terrible. The traffic after she closed Broadway was terrible. But actually it was better because this crazy diagonal intersection was gone. So she has nice square intersections through that area. Actually, the traffic flows better. I'll end this topic by just to mention walkability. If, as architects and designers, if we do only one thing, making our world walkable is the smallest gesture that we can do to have the greatest impact. That it is literally the thing that affects human health. It increases the connectedness of our cities, because frankly, if you can't walk from one place to another, you can't be very connected, et cetera. So think about walkability in everything you do. Number eight, my personal career favorite, which is culture and heritage. Recognizing that we are contributing to the culture recognizing that there's culture that's come before us. To a great extent, this is us getting sensitive to the true value, the universal value of the legacy that we've inherited, and really being fully appreciative of it. Cultural heritage is something that, you know, we've been talked about for 50 years since the Preservation Act was passed in 1966. But I still feel like we're in the early stages of this conversation. We don't really believe it as a society. But there's something that's going to propel us to really be thinking more in terms of cultural and heritage preservation. And that is, let's go back to climate change. Let's go back to the impacts of what we do. So this chart, which is from the CBEX Commercial Building Energy Survey, shows us generations of buildings. Each one of these is basically a decade of building. As you can see, economic projections are showing that there's still going to be a lot of growth, but it's not unprecedented. We've seen growth like this before. It also shows that there's a lot of renovation work that needs to be done. Almost 2 to 1. The amount of renovation work that you will do in your career as a student today compared to new building work. And it's just the numbers, okay? It's not philosophy, it's the numbers. Part of this is also that look where the big orange bars are. The big orange bars are mid-century modern buildings. And that generation of buildings is a completely different set of challenges. The generation of perhaps the worst performing buildings that have ever been built. And now we have to find their value and reinvest in them in effective ways to actually make them be part of the 21st century solution. We can't tear them down. We don't have enough landfills to throw them in. We have to find a way to make them viable buildings and meet 21st century standards. That is actually the single biggest architectural challenge that we're faced with in terms of numbers, making good the future of the mid-century modern buildings. And fortunately, again, there's good literature. There are practitioners that have their sleeves rolled up and really understand how to green existing buildings, even precious historic buildings. There's great resources for us to draw on. We're not alone. And I'll just remind you of, we want to reduce that footprint by 50% to get to that Paris Agreement number, to get to that 2050 goal. Again, 3 or 4 times more renovation than what we're doing now here in the U.S. It's a jobs program. Let's embrace this. Coming down home stretch here, number 9. I have yet to be in a community as an AI leader where affordability is not part of the topic. I'll just give you the example right now, San Diego. The San Diego architectural community is engaged with the city writ large on 3 issues. One is projected growth in the city by 2050 of 1 million people. It's a lot more people, and look at them. Got an ocean here, got a desert there, got a border here. There's not a lot of places to grow. They have a real issue with how in the world they're going to have another 1 million people in their city. Issue number 2 is housing affordability. And in San Diego, like with a lot of other West Coast cities, whether you have no money in the bank or you have $1 million in the bank and you're looking for a new apartment, you have an affordability issue. Everything is unaffordable. And, you know, the teachers can't live in town, the firefighters can't live in town, the policemen can't live in town, et cetera. It's a real issue, not just in San Diego. The 3rd issue is homelessness. And what San Diego has done is said, those are not 3 problems. Those are 1 problem. It's all the same. It's all about having a city in which the systems can support all the people that need to be here in ways that are affordable to them. Aravena's work is something that I would really encourage you to take a look at. And you know, this project, this Quinta Monroy housing in Chile, his client for this was actually the copper mining industry. So this is kind of like a community, you know, give back program. And after the earthquake in 2011, there was a lot of devastation. And so the copper company came to him and said, Alejandro, we've got this great site out here on the edge of town that we got for cheap, and we want you to build this affordable housing project for these people in this neighborhood here that got devastated by the earthquake. And he said, crazy, no, that doesn't work at all. You're going to destroy their society by putting them out there. How are they going to get to work? You know, you have this whole network of people, so let's just fix their houses. And the numbers that he was given to work with were, ready for this, $7,500 per unit, total cost, okay, including land. And that they really felt like in order to be able to numbers work on this city, in-town city property, that they actually had to triple the density of the site. So he came back to them with this design that did that. I'm not spending any more money, $7,500 per unit, triple the density, making these kind of townhouse units in a neighborhood that wasn't typically vertical. So we've accomplished this. And then there's one other thing that I, an architect, as a social entrepreneur, also want to do, and that is I want to design upward mobility into this project. So we did this sawtooth building design that allows the infill of the buildings, that empty space, to be infilled by the owners. And typically, the owner is able to do that for about something like $1,500 per unit. So they are doubling the amount of space they have for a fraction of the cost of the building. And literally what they're doing is they're making their property more valuable. They're getting more out of it than they're putting into it. Because of the popularity of the, Alejandro Aravena, this is such an interesting project. There's all these people coming and taking pictures of it. You know what these units are selling for today? $50,000. So he has taken a neighborhood that had a poverty problem and an earthquake problem, and he's given them decent housing, he's given them self-expression, and he's given them upward mobility. I don't know of any U.S. housing projects that have included upward mobility as a design criteria. I want to, on this subject, just point to the work of Mindy Fullilove, who talks about the need for us to think in terms of whole cities. And when she means whole, she means whole in a humanistic sense. And her criteria is so simple. It just has to be good enough. People have to be able to feel like they're settled in that place, they belong there. They have to be able to feel like they actually have a responsibility to take care of it. And they also have to have the ability to deal with each other. The kids next door are throwing rocks through the windows. You have to be able to go out in your neighborhood and say, hey, you kids, stop that. And if you can't do that in your neighborhood, you don't have a good neighborhood. Because you can't affect the social network of your neighborhood. And that measure, there's a lot of neighborhoods that you would be surprised are not good neighborhoods because you can't really deal with each other. And the one other thing that with Mindy's work, she wants to make sure that we remember, and this is an important lesson for us as architects, this stuff didn't just happen. The neighborhood patterns in our cities happened as a result of policies and programs that were intentional. Redlining happened. I'm not going to say every banker in 1950 was a racist. Every banker in 1950 wanted to make sure their loans got paid back. But to them, at that point, the way that they would know, the way that they would assure themselves that they would get paid back was by making decisions based on race. And that's what they did. And that's what led to the conditions that we deal with today. These things didn't just happen. So last but not least, number 10. Beautiful, joyful, inspiring cities. And I have to reference back to Jane Jacobs, who really, I think, in the 20th century, in the mid-20th century, laid it out for us about the choices that we had to make about what we're doing with developing our communities. What matters? Is it the people that live in those communities, or is it the cars that drive through those communities? And, you know, that battle goes on to this day. It's relevant as much as ever. Again, there's lots of great literature on this. Juan Gell is my favorite guy here, telling us that we can actually design cities that are human-centered cities, and that the spaces that we make can be great spaces for people, number one criteria. How deep does that go? And this is, I've referenced a lot of different materials in this, great reading list, but this is the one you have to read. This is the assignment that everybody has, which is to read Sarah Williams Goldhagen's Welcome to Your World, just published in April. The first 20-page introduction of this lays out in the clearest terms you could ever want to see it, how deep does this human impact go? All the way to the bone. All the way to creating human identity. All the way to creating human memory. And this is on a neurological level that I'm not a brain scientist, so I'm going to say this in probably improper and overly simplistic terms, but the part of the brain, the hippocampus, that records memory and retrieves memory also perceives space. So there's a lot of people like these memory experts that can memorize 500 words. All of them do that by having a spatial relationship to how they memorize. So they literally, like, they walk through the house they grew up in their mind, and you put number one down on the table next to the door, and then they take the second number and they put it next to the chair next to the table and door, and they walk through the house and they put the number down. And then they go back to remember it and they pick the numbers up. They have this spatial cognition of that they relate their memory to. Guess what? That's how the brain works. No wonder that works. So that is the how profound that literally our brains are shaped by the environment. And let me just put it in another term. If you grew up in a neighborhood where basically the environment is terrible, it's telling you that people don't care about you, would you ever want to grow up to be an architect? Would that thought ever even cross your mind that you could shape the built environment, and that by shaping the built environment, it would improve the lives of you and the people around you? So these things are really important when you look at them in terms of their social impact. That going back to Toynbee's statement, we actually have a duty as the architectural profession to shape the conditions of the built environment that everybody grows up in so they can have the opportunity to live to their potential. The environment is not separate from that. The environment is central to that. That's part of our job. And I want to go back to the 19th century example that I gave you to kind of conclude this by saying, so remember all those people dying in New York City from infectious disease? Well, what did the American Institute of Architects do? Literally, you know, Daniel Burnham, former president of the American Institute of Architects. By the way, I can't believe I'm gonna be on the same list as Daniel Burnham. Unbelievable. But what did they do? They did, yeah, pipes, they're great, sewers, yeah, all that stuff's good. But what we need is we need beautiful cities. We need cities that are inspiring to live in. We need cities that demonstrate the best of human potential. We need libraries and schools and museums. We need parks. And they created the City Beautiful movement. So what did the architects do faced with that challenge of killing people with their cities? They didn't just say, okay, not killing people is the goal. They said, no, beautiful cities are the goal. So what's our beautiful city? What's the 21st century City Beautiful 2.0 that we are going to rise up as a profession and create to take the 21st century machines for living that got created by people like Robert Moses and turn them into the 21st century cities for people that Jane Jacobs has been asking us to create for more than 50 years now. So can we do this? And I'll end with this last thought. You know, Margaret Mead made it really clear, how do things get done in this world? Inspired, committed, small groups of people saying, damn it, we're gonna get this done. Well, 90,000 members of the American Institute of Architects sounds like a lot of people, but it's not in the context of a country that has 320 million people in it. We, the architects of America, are a small group of committed people. Let's get committed. Let's do this job. Our relevance as a profession depends on it. Literally, our jobs depend on it. So we have a lot of self-motivation to do it. But literally, the world around us has now, with two international agreements, come to us and said, we are asking you to redefine what your goals as a profession are. Will you please help us solve the social and economic and environmental issues that face us today? So will we hold ourselves accountable to do this? Will we rise to this relevancy? Will we seize the relevance that the world has given us? That's why I want to be president today. Next year, I want to try to bring this into the clearest focus and help us get to the 21st century definition of the challenges and opportunities for our profession. So thanks for letting me be here with you today.
Thank you very much, Carl. I'm looking at the clock, and I know some people have some commitments out there. So what I'm going to encourage everyone to do is join us out in the gallery. I think there's some snacks and some drinks. And you'll have a chance, if you've got questions for Carl or want to engage him a little further in some of the ideas that he presented today, we'd love for you to join us just outside.